left this up here. Because I like where we left off. And I was curious, I mean, Richard wasn't here, but there's a couple of people that wanted to be more here. We started out, I just put fears on the boards. Like, what are we afraid of? What kind of fears do we experience? You know, we're looking at kidney fear and such, and what it came into, you know, decisiveness or indecision, afraid of making the wrong choice was one. Fear of the unknown. It's like, I don't know what's on the other side of that door. I don't know if I open this door, what's on the other side, right? Fear of being misunderstood, which we talked about that. It's a big one for a lot of people. And it was a big one for me. It can still be, but it was a big one for me. Fear of rejection. Fear of success was brought up. Fear of making things worse. Right? If I get more involved, am I going to make things worse instead of better? I'm trying to help. I don't know how many of you have said that, but I've said that a lot. I'm trying to help, but you're just making things worse. From people who won't be named. Fear of failure. Right? These are all big ones. Are there any other ones that we want to add?
Fear that it's my fault.
Talk to me about that.
It's more than my fault. It's a fear that how do I say it? It's if something goes wrong, it's not that it went wrong. It was my fault that it went wrong.
Wouldn't that fall under fear of failure?
I think it's a little different the way I'm expressing it for me.
Okay.
It's blaming myself, not that I failed. It's blaming myself that I failed. One, I didn't reach the mark. One, I'm afraid that I failed. The other is the second arrow, is the fear that it's my fault that I failed. It's a lessening of my personhood for the experience that I have.
Does that fall under fear?
I'm not so sure it does as much as the sense of shame. Yeah, I don't think it's a fear that we're looking at it as something that we're afraid of. It's more of an internalized feeling of blaming oneself. I don't think it falls under fear.
Well, I mean, I think that the fear is a failure, mm-hmm. and then the consequence of that failure is a feeling of shame or not good enough.
Goes to levels from there.
Right, it drops into how we feel about the failure.
Yeah, I think it's more that context, yeah.
Okay.
Makes sense.
How about a fear of repetition? You've done something, it didn't work, you have to go do it again, you have a fear it's not going to work again.
Well, doesn't that fall under fear of failure?
No. What if it's something like, what if you're going downtown Dallas and you get attacked?
Yeah.
And you have to go back downtown Dallas. That's not your failure.
Okay, well, so you said you're going to do something and it failed and then you're going to go, you're afraid of. Okay, so
something
coming
like
at it from a self-defense
or just
a vulnerability perspective,
yeah.
So I was in a situation, didn't think I was vulnerable, became vulnerable.
Or like
maybe
car
got hurt. Car accident.
Fear of repeat, I can see that.
Yeah. Now I understand what you're saying. So, a historic precedent.
Yeah.
Whether it's an accident, an assault, maybe you failed a class in school and you're afraid you're going to fail it again.
Yeah.
Okay. Right? That can
light or something.
This is where, you know, when we talk about that, the timeline of, I have new markers, now versus future versus past, and I'll often say, you know, fear is a future-focused process, but here you're describing something in the past, let's just use a car accident as an example. That'll keep it from being too triggering. There was a car accident here, right? And it can be any trauma, anything that was very stressful for the individual, but we'll say this. Car accident, and that happened in the past, and now I'm here now, but I'm having to go back. Maybe my path is taking me through that area where the accident happened.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, are we all on, is this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, the phobias, agoraphobia,
mm-hmm.
acrophobia, a past trauma or difficulty, having to re-engage it.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Carrying that history, but going back to repeat it.
Right, right. And the adage of, you know, get back on the horse or get back in the car as soon as possible.
Exactly.
Things like that. Sometimes that can work. It depends on the intensity of the experience. But so in this case, we're going to end up going back through the same area. Maybe I have to go back and visit the same place that I was going to before. It's off the beaten path, and the accident happened. So now I'm projecting a past experience into a very near future, right? And it's triggering fear. So some people will say, and I've heard this many times over the years in working with different groups, that means that that fear is in the past. And it's like, no. To me, no, it's not fear in the past. I am taking a past experience that sucked really bad, and I'm projecting it into a future, so my fear is coming from here.
Sort of still carrying a fear pattern, so to speak, in your thought process.
Well, there's a history of pain, and as humans, we move away from pain and towards pleasure. There are caveats. That pleasure-pain balance is a very interesting dance in the human being. But
will that fear eventually go away by itself if you, like in this situation, if you kept going through that intersection or whatever, and nothing happens, so that you have more positive experiences with that situation than you did with the accident?
I think that there's some truth to that, that over time your experience will soften the intensity of the previous single experience. Multiple experiences soften the intensity of the previous one. But I think that as humans, we have this amazing ability to ruminate and to get locked into a time space. And we have this event in our past, right? Somewhere in our past. And we keep spinning around it. We keep bringing it up. We keep thinking about it. So even, you know, say I had this accident a couple of years ago, and then one of my coworkers comes in and says, man, I just had a near miss. It's like, oh God, you know, 2 years ago I got, you know, I had this. And so we bring it back up and we stir those feelings again, and we keep enhancing reinforcing the pathways, the neural pathways to that memory, to that trigger.
Yeah.
And so we can get into that, and the thing about if we get into just trauma in general, so fear is, you know, one of those components that's an early warning system for trauma. If I'm feeling fear about something, that means that somewhere in my mind, in my being, I am perceiving a threat. Usually it's off of some past experiences. So if, like, you're driving and everything's cool, and then all of a sudden you're turning, you know, down the street where you had a major car accident, that the alarm bells that were set during the trauma are going to start going off.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, this is taking a turn that I didn't expect it to, but it's good.
Chris,
I like it.
Comment on one thing first, if I could.
Let me get this on the board.
Sure.
Because if I don't, it'll just go.
I got you.
So when we're looking at trauma, it's a different part of the brain that records it.
Yes.
There's a conscious brain, the prefrontal cortex, our thinking, the one that I'm hoping you're using now. And then there's the primal memory. So if we look at the brain like this, you've got the prefrontal cortex here, which is, you know, where we have our learning, and it's the executive function, our decision-making, planning, organizing, math magician, all that kind of stuff. But there's a part of the brain that is primal. It is very primal. And in that primal brain, we have a high-definition memory. Now, I'm really simplifying neuroscience here, but, so forgive me, but there is a high-definition memory there that when we experience a trauma, like a car accident, all five senses are recorded for that event in high definition. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And alarm bells are set. So, visually, if I'm turning into that intersection, or if I see a vehicle that is the same make and model, color, or if I see somebody driving erratically that's similar to when this other person gave me a bad day, that visual alarm's gonna go off. It may only go off a little bit, or it may go off intensely, depending on the threat, and depending on how strong this is for you, how intense the emotions are around it. So then, all five senses will have input into the intensity of the alarm. If I just see something out of the corner of my eye, it may get just a very little blip and kind of get my attention. My memory will go back to, hey, remember, be careful, right? But as more of the alarms are going off, the more intense the response that I'm going to have, the reaction I'm going to have. On a surface level, if it's just barely getting my attention, I'm going to have the ability to respond using the front of the brain. If I'm in full-on panic mode, like this is a major threat, I'm going to go to reactionary. Does that make sense? These two parts of the brain don't operate at the same time. We're either responding, thinking, planning, organizing, even if it's within fractions of a second, or we're reacting. Reacting is very black and white. You think friend or foe, you're with me or against me. When we get into that mindset, Pinocchio, eyeball. When we get, you know, typically our periphery and such is like this. We have perspective. When our mind is online and we're looking at things, we see things, we may input stuff, whatnot, but we have good visual field. We have our thinking brain online. Everything's honky-dory. We're just enjoying ourselves. Then these bells start to go off, maybe one at a time, and our field of vision and our field of thought, equally important, start to narrow. We start to lose this out here. And when we get into what's described as tunnel vision, when we really get into this primal fight or flight, we're here.
Mm-hmm.
And all of this potential input is gone. This is where, you know, in my work with law enforcement, this is where an officer is in a situation that's life or death. And they have to make a split-second decision on whether to fire their weapon or not.
It's
and then...
Firefighters. Yeah,
huh?
Or a firefighter that's out there now.
Well, I've done some of that, and I think it's different for them, firefighters. There are circumstances where it can be very, you know, if I'm in a burning building and the structure starts to fail, yeah, we're going to go here and be like, gotta go.
Mm-hmm.
But it feels, I don't know, it feels different to me.
Yeah.
It feels different. Because I've been in buildings on fire, and I've had guns pointed at me. It's a very different feeling.
Well,
both are threatening,
yeah,
but I'm trained for one, not trained for the other, right?
Yeah.
So in this, what we're looking to do is, when we're addressing fear, is the fuel that will motivate us to pay attention, to react to a situation. If I'm not afraid, like a toddler, they've never seen stairs before, they're going to go, "What's that?" You know, they're just going to go. And then when they get to the bottom of the stairs and they've had their trauma, then the next time they're going to go, "Oh God, I don't want to go there," right? They're going to have that awareness that fear is what fuels a different decision, fuels a change of behavior. Now, in some cases, it may be that the trauma was so intense that they could never, every time they see a flight of stairs, as an example, they go into panic. Yeah.
I think all of those fears cluster around a previous experience, except maybe even the unknown, where something frightening, devastating, really, as you're describing, had a kind of a semi-traumatic impact. And that's why it's lodged. And the same converse is true. Wonderful memories. A new child doing an unbelievable feat out of nowhere are also lodged in the hippocampus. We have strong positive memories where it takes all the pictures, and traumatically strong negative. But it really, that made sense to me about repetition, because I said, wow, someone's not afraid of rejection unless they've been really rejected and the context of that rejection.
Right, and the emotions that were felt under that.
That context, yeah.
Right.
Where does fear come in relationship to trauma, if it's not your trauma, but it's projected on you? Like,
that's one of the amazing things about, go ahead.
I'll go back to the dog bite situation. Say if somebody in your family got bit by a dog, that makes you afraid of dogs,
mm-hmm.
even though it wasn't you that got bit.
Right.
How does that fall in? Is that fear of the unknown, or is that fear of trauma? Is that the trauma still? Because it's association.
Right, and that's one of the things I think about the human. I mean, I can't speak to other animals with the way their brain works, but we have the ability to learn from other people's mistakes or failures or damage or traumas. I don't believe it'll be the same intensity, but I can see how... Thank you, Richard.
Take care.
I don't believe it'll be the same intensity, but I think it could easily be the same, obviously the same fear connecting to it. I'm afraid I'm going to get hurt, or I'm afraid somebody I love is going to get hurt by a dog.
Yeah, because I've seen that projected from like parents to their children.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Fear of spiders.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's very few fear of snakes. There's only 5 venomous snakes in the United States, but everybody's freaked out about a little garden snake.
But they're all little.
It's only one that's really little.
What about fear when you're feeling vulnerable situations? So if you're sitting in your hallway and there's a tornado coming over, or there's crime in your neighborhood, I mean, is that...
Well, there's an uncertainty component to it, right? I think that the uncertainty is a big part of that. Things that are out of our control. You know, I see some of my clients, and I've got quite a few like this, and even in hospital this morning, I was talking to a couple of people that the anxiety comes from not feeling like, not having a sense of strength in themselves that they can manage situations that are outside their control. Right? So like the home invasion kind of thing that you're talking about. There's so many factors in that I don't have control of. Right? And so when we get into that, we're looking at You think about in Chinese medicine, in here we're looking at, you know, the balance to fear is wisdom. Right? So the stronger my fear, the less my wisdom. Especially when we're dealing with fear of the unknown. I don't know. So my wisdom is lacking, and that's increasing my potential for fear. The storms, you know, we had the tornado that devastated a lot of Dallas, right? 16-mile path and all of that stuff. I watched it go over my house. I never felt fear because I've done search and rescue in tornadoes. I've been in situations like that. I haven't had the devastation, but peripherally I have seen the intensity of the damage. But I was standing in front of my house and I'm saying, there it is. And then I was like, wow. And it landed about half a mile behind my house and did more devastation before it finally went away. But I can't say that I was completely calm, but I wasn't freaked out either. But I have a level of wisdom about what to do, and I already had everybody in the house battened down, and I had my go bag with me. So, there was a lot that I had wisdom of pre-preparation and such. So I wasn't as afraid as somebody who's doesn't have any knowledge, any experience, no preparations, right? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And so in the case of like the home invasion thing, what I want to do, and you and I kind of did this a little bit, but what I want to do is start taking an account of how I can build wisdom. How can I increase my wisdom around this home invasion fear so that my fear subsides? And so there's, you know, the police department will bring an officer. You can call and ask for this, and it's on, you know, that there's community resource officers and such that'll often do this, but they'll come out and they'll walk the perimeter of the property, they'll look at your doors, they'll look at your windows, and they'll give you a list of things to do to reinforce your home. Free. You can get a security system if you don't have one. You can make sure you know how to use your security system. And if there's a panic aspect to that, you make sure you know about that. You test it, right? You reinforce the doors. You reinforce the windows. If you've got windows that are sticking, get them unstuck. Make sure that you have exit strategies, right? Little things that start to build a library of wisdom. You know, think about why they do fire drills in schools and public buildings and such, because they want people to have a little bit of automatic memory. Oh, this is what we do in case of this. Now, I know that when we were kids, or at least when I was a kid, the getting under the desk and kissing your ass goodbye because there was a nuclear bomb is not, you know, it's like that was just pretend safety. But
that was that false sense of security.
But I do remember when I was in middle school, I do remember a time when there was a tornado. The sirens were going off and everything outside was green, which is very ominous. Not luminous, ominous. And we were all in the hallway, and I remember feeling vulnerable and afraid. And that's part of the reason that there's several different events when I was a kid that made me want to build a library. What happens in flooding, tornado, fire, things like that, right? So being able to identify a fear and work to strengthen wisdom around it is critical to being able to settle that fear.
Somebody made money on a book that's called Worst Case Scenarios that does that.
Yeah.
It's like if you're drowning in quicksand, what do you do? It goes through all of these extreme things. And there's books out on that.
You know, when we're looking at, if we're going into a future, because we're talking about fear being future focused, if I'm here and I'm looking at this potential possibility like a car accident, right? Like the original scenario. I want to look at the worst case, and I want to look at best case, right? And worst case, let's just say, worst case, I die in the car accident. That would suck really bad. Be kind of permanent.
No more migraines, though.
No more migraines. Bonus.
That's what they look at.
Way to look, way to look at the bright side.
Worst case, you get injured and terribly and don't die.
And still here.
Yeah, well, right below death would be, you know, paralysis.
Yeah, that's
right. Partial paralysis or something, brain damage, where you become a burden to the people that matter to you, right? So we're looking at these different cases, and so when we go there, we can either just say, well, I'll just deal with it if it happens, or we can make contingency plans. We can have a living will. We can have different things in place that if this were to happen, at least my family would be protected or taken care of to the best of my ability. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So even though this would be horrible, I can subdue some of the fear if I bring in and work with some of the wisdom that I can manifest for that potential. This is where we often lose our we reinforce fear without realizing that we can actually settle it quite a bit by just preparing, by doing things, simple things. And some of them are complicated, but having all of your account information, you know, one of the things that we did as a family is we have a password manager, and we have our oldest son as a secondary contact that can actually get access to all of our passwords if necessary. And so if I go, then they have access to all my stuff. If Fane goes, then same thing. I mean, and you know, we use that as a way to, because so much of our lives right now, if you think about it,
mm-hmm.
is based on a username and passwords. And so I want them to have access to that information.
And you need a list, because a lot of people don't even get statements or anything else. So, I mean, I thought that. I mean, if you die, they don't even know what you're
doing. They have no idea where to look.
Or whatever.
Right,
so,
right.
Yeah, I mean, a notebook, too.
Right. So there's, you know, list, ledger, however, whatever feels good to you. But those are the kinds of things you can do to soften the impact of a fear by balancing it with wisdom. Right? And then if we look at the best case scenario, it's a fender bender, they have insurance, and my car gets a new paint job. Right? Then if I can manage this, you know, even though it would be horrible, if I can get myself to manage this, then everything below is doable. Make sense? So, where are we going? You speechless. Result. Does that help?
Yeah.
Marcia?
That's a lot, thanks.
Mm-hmm. You know, the key here, understanding, we talked about the first class, we talked about the physiology of fear and the adrenaline and the, I talked about the neuroscience today with regards to the tunnel vision that we get into, that black and white thinking that gets us to a place where we can't think clearly. We're not making reasonable decisions. We're making what we perceive at some level to be life-threatening decisions, whether they really are or not. I mean, I've had people in an absolute panic over something that I look at and go, I don't see it. That doesn't make their reality any less true, because it is to them. I mean, I think I've shared the story before. I had one lady in a hospital who was beside herself over a broken nail. And it wasn't an injured nail. It was just ugly. It had broken her pretty shiny nail. But that was her truth. And she was in fight or flight over it. She really was. She had gotten herself worked up to a point of black and white thinking, Everybody in this hospital is against me. And so the caution is, when we start to, one defense mechanism that I see a lot with regards to fears is, judgment. We dismiss, did I spell that right? We dismiss our own fears, our own anxieties, our own stressors, because they don't match up to what we think is reasonable. We see other people dealing with things that are way worse, and why can't I deal with it? Does that make sense? No?
Mm-hmm.
Well, car accident. Let's go back to the car accident. So I have, my dad had a car accident, and you know, he was okay, everything was fine, and his car was banged up, and he was pretty upset about it. You know, and I looked at it, it's like, still drivable. I'm a mechanic. I have that wisdom of being able to look at it. I don't see any structural damage. It's all skin. We can fix that. Right? Now, the insurance company had totaled it, but that's a whole other story. But in that situation, his level of stress and intensity over that was much higher than mine. Right? It's like, yeah, the bumper's off, but I can put that back on. Here, let me do it. Yeah, I did it. It's back on. What is intense or overwhelming to one person could be nothing to another that's had an entire lifetime of other experiences, right?
Judgment being more associated with wisdom than declaring something bad or good.
No, I think that where judgment comes in for me is when what I'm talking about here is like self-talk. Where I'm finding myself afraid of something, and it, even to me, in comparison to my friends, let's say, why would I be afraid of this? Why would I be stressed over this? It doesn't make sense, you know, it seems stupid, you know. I'm freaked out over X, and nobody else around me that's experiencing it is freaking out over it. Why am I freaking out over it? And so there's a harsh judgment that something wrong with me for having a different reaction to a situation. Does that help? This is a painful perspective.
Kind of like when you're not afraid of, or when you're afraid of going into a haunted house, but all your friends are like, come on.
Yeah,
let's eat,
for me, roller coasters. I was an aircraft mechanic. I've studied stress mechanics, as stress factor. I know physics, you know, I mean, I've read books. I will not get on a roller coaster. I mean, I didn't like it, because I know that the inspection protocols for an airplane are way stricter, having experienced them, than the inspection protocols on a roller coaster. And so the level of potential harm in my mind from corrosion, dissimilar metal corrosion, stress fractures that can't be seen, but can shear at any moment in time under the right forces, you know, they have to be done with x-ray machines. They have to be, you know, it's like, do they do that with roller coasters? And I think they look at it and go, bolt's loose. Okay, we're good.
So what
and
fear
I'm
is
minimizing
it?
The level of mechanical, you know, but that's the way it feels to me. So it's just my feelings. I'm not attacking roller coaster
people. I say, so what fear is it that you just projected onto those who thought they liked roller coasters, but now they trusted you and are going, I'm not doing a roller coaster again.
Fair point. So it's a dance, it's a balance. And I think that the judgment comes in when we expect something of ourselves that's not reasonable. We haven't had a life experience that allows us to have a perspective different than what we have. We would have had to live parallel lives. My best friend, who I've known since I was, you know, young. You know, some of you guys met Wes. I mean, he and I have known each other since fourth grade. We grew up together in a sense, but then we separated, you know, not divorced or anything. He moved somewhere else and we just stopped seeing each other as often. So his life experience, life path, is very different than mine. Come back together now 40 years later, and it's like he has a different set of values, different set of perspectives, fears, things like that than I do. Not right or wrong, just different. So if we're traveling, you know, through time, and at one point we were, you know, we spent a lot of time together, and then he went this way and I went this way, for me to be here and expect that I have the same perspective as he does is not good. I want to say stupid. But it's just not healthy. It's not good. Because it's not possible. I can't see things exactly the way he sees them. Because I haven't lived his life. Now, if he expects me to see things a certain way, and I don't, and he doesn't agree with that, then we're not going to be friends very long. Unless we come to some mutual understanding.
Even siblings or mates, you would have that same...
With our three boys, they grew up in the same house, right? And they all three have different perspectives on life. Mm-hmm. And they grew up under the same roof with the same parents.
But you weren't the same. And I saw this with mine. Right. My parents had those seven kids out over 20 years. So the parents that had the one that's 20 years younger than me, they were different parents.
We were different parents from our oldest to our youngest. I actually wrote a poem about this. It was kind of funny, though. With the first child, it's like, you know, oh, be careful, don't do this, don't do that, you know. Don't touch that, it's dirty, pacifier, falls on the floor, you pick it up and you blow it for 10 minutes, you know. I wrote a poem about this about 15, 18 years ago. And, you know, the second child's like, oh, 10-second rule, here's your pacifier. And the third one's like, don't eat so much cardboard before dinner. You know, you're going to ruin your... And so it does change. Yeah. And they grew up in a different house, even though the house was relatively the same, the people, the dynamics of the life. So all these experiences that they have, if they were not to have the ability to see each other for who they are and where they are, then their lives would be really difficult if they expected one to behave like the others. Why don't you just let it go? Well, I can't. Why not? I just can't. Right? Well, I can let it go. I can't. I have to work on it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? Why does this make you angry? I don't know, it just does. We all have that in different ways with different people around us. Right? Fair? That's part of being human. But that judgmental, that harshness, when we turn it inside to ourselves and we see things that make us feel weak or vulnerable and we come down with a hammer, that's not helpful. I actually had this conversation with somebody this morning where we were doing a basic Qigong practice, and I could feel her starting to really get upset because it was just wheels off the bus. First time I've met her, first time I've seen her, very basic practice, but it was causing her a lot of stress. And I went up to her and I said, like, what's going on? And she's like, I can't get my breath right. I was like, just hang on, let's just simplify it. Just take the hands out. Focus on the breath, and then if you don't feel like doing the weight shift, we were doing cloud step. This was later in class, and she'd been doing okay, but then when that happened and the wheels came off the bus, she started reacting very poorly towards herself. She started getting really, she saw the other people in the class, and some of them were struggling too, but in different ways, and it wasn't as visually apparent. When I talked to them individually, they were all dealing with managing the practice, but for her, she thought she was the only one in the class that wasn't doing it right. And it started really eating her up. And I caught it and started talking to her, and I had her take it down to a simpler practice, and I asked her to stop being so hard on herself. Recognize that when you notice something is not right, that's a good thing, because then you can do something about it. But I've had people that I work with, there's like, I'm doing it perfect, it's wonderful, you know, and it's like, well, you're going to hurt yourself if you don't stop. But I gave her permission to let go of judgment, and that gave her permission to be in a smaller space, and in the last 10 minutes of class, there was a much more relaxed, settled person in front of me. But she had a fear of failure. Big time. And there was a mental component that was really coming down hard on herself.
Some of the other students could have had a fear of failure too, but not showing it.
Correct.
Pulling it in, which is...
They did. So there was one that had pain. So she was afraid that she was going to cause more pain. Another one that was very much in his head that was afraid of, he would lose track. He would get distracted and such. And so he was afraid he was going to lose track. I mean, if we're looking at just the fear, one was afraid of showing vulnerability. And he said so in class. He said that, you know, I normally never tell anybody if I'm hurting or something like that, because he told me he was having some pain in mid-back from the practice that we were doing, so I made a postural alignment adjustment, and it took the pain away. But he said, after class, I never tell anybody that. I don't know. I just normally push through. So he was afraid to seem vulnerable. All right, so everybody in there had fears. There was a couple of other people, but everybody in there had fears. They were just different. But she perceived she was the only one suffering. Everybody else was doing perfect or beautiful. And they were all suffering inside in some way. Right?
Future expectations appearing real is how that was, fear was defined to me.
Yeah. That's a future expectations appearing real.
I'm never going to be able to do this class. I'm never going to, whatever. You can just go all the way down that, I'll never get this. Yeah.
Right.
That judgment.
Right. I'm too, like, people maybe come into class and say, this is over my head. I've had people say, this is over my head, or I don't get it. And instead of asking and, you know, kind of challenging me to go a little deeper or look at it differently, they just say, well, it's not for me, or I don't get it, or I'm too stupid, or whatever their statement is. And, you know, those can be strong defense mechanisms to protect ourselves from pain. But if we take that away and just go to trust. So if you think about the grandmother to fear is trust, spleen energy. If I trust that I'm here, I'm going to get what I need today. Right? I don't know what I'm going to say when I get up here with you guys. I left the stuff on the board this time because I didn't think we were done. And I didn't know where it was going to go. I felt before class that that needed to stay on the board. Not because I was too lazy to erase it, I swear. And what that did for me was just said, okay, we've got a starting point, but I had no idea where this was going to go. I trust that, not that I'm this be-all, know-all, end-all, but that between us, we're going to come to some interesting conclusions and perspectives. And that's, to me, that's the goal of this class, right? To explore and play, not to read it out of a textbook. Questions? Thank you for your time and attention.
Yeah.